sing praise, alleluia, gloria, sing praise. Gloria, sing praise, alleluia, gloria, sing praise.
Come celebrate the gift of the ages,
Jesus Christ is born.
Come celebrate, you saints and you sages,
Jesus Christ is born.
Emmanuel is lying in a manger,
Jesus Christ is born.
So come and worship this tiny little stranger,
Jesus Christ is born.
Glory sing the choirs of angels,
hallelujah, the shepherds cry,
peace on earth.
Welcome to Pleasant Grove Community Church's video service for the fourth Sunday of Advent. We have a real special service today filled with a lot of Christmas music that we hope will just lift your spirit. Hi, I'm Lois Cody. I'm the Minister to Women and Office Administrator here at the church, and we are just so delighted that you decided to tune us in today. Thank you for joining us. Now, please remember today is the last day to drop off groceries for our Christmas food drive. You can drop those off on the west side of the building under the portico in the gray tote there. If you do that by 4 p.m., we'll get those picked up and put together with the other groceries that have been being dropped off all week. If you can't come by the church and drop those off, you can also call Nelson and Bev Schmidt and arrange for a pickup at your home. Now, this coming week, all of our Advent preparations are culminating into the Christmas Eve service and celebration of Jesus's birth. There will be a special video service for Christmas Eve, so be watching YouTube and your daily email for the link to that service, and join us as we celebrate the birth of Christ. Also, next Sunday, we wanted to be sure you knew that we'll be highlighting Wiley Wilkin and his family as they prepare to move to Tennessee. We're so grateful for the years that Wiley has been here and the blessing that he and his family have been. And in preparation to say goodbye, we'll be interviewing them. So be sure to tune in next Sunday as well. Now let's move into worship with the lighting of the Advent candle of love.
Hello, we're the Bellowbrook family, and we're going to light the candle of love today. This reading's from Isaiah 61, 1 through 4, 10 through 11. The Spirit of God, the Master, is on me because God anointed me. He sent me to preach good news to the poor, heal the heartbroken, announce freedom to all captives, pardon all prisoners. God sent me to announce the year of His grace, a celebration of God's destruction of our enemies, and to comfort all who mourn.
To care for the needs of all who mourn in Zion, give them bouquets of roses instead of ashes, messages of joy instead of news of doom, a praising heart instead of a languid spirit. Rename them oaks of righteousness planted by God to display His glory. They'll rebuild the old ruins, raise a new city out of the wreckage. They'll start over on the ruined cities, take the rubble left behind and make it new.
I will sing for joy in God, explode in praise from deep in my soul. He dressed me up in a suit of salvation. He outfitted me in a robe of righteousness. As a bridegroom who puts on a tuxedo and a bride a jeweled tiara. For as the earth bursts with spring wildflowers and as a garden cascades with blossoms, so the Master God brings righteousness into full bloom and puts praise on display before the nations.
Please pray with us.
God of love, we worship you. There is no one on earth or in heaven who loves us as well as you do. When we sin, behave selfishly, and even hurt others, you continue to extend your grace on to us.
We are undeserving of your compassion, but that does not stop you from loving us without ceasing. We praise you, Father, for no matter how sinful we may be, you will forever be worthy. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Amen.
Come to Bethlehem.
mercies, Deo.
Thank you. Well, as we come to a time of prayer during this Advent season, I wanted to read just a verse from 1 John 4:16. John writes this, "And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in them." Great words for us this Advent as we focus today on the love of God. Let's look to God in prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, at this Advent season, when we wait patiently, when we watch carefully, when we remember mindfully, we also can experience your love for us firsthand, fresh, right now in this time. And we can find in you today a fresh encounter that renews our peace, our hope, our joy, and the love that you and you alone can provide. Today we look with fresh hearts at that desire to find strength for life in the love that you have shown to us in Christ Jesus. We celebrate the coming of the child that means salvation for us. Good news. Thank you for good news. Thank you for your most gracious gift of Christ. And I would just encourage us in just a moment to just quietly thank God for the gift of Jesus in your life. We're humbled for your concern for us, God, for your care of us, and for your steadfast commitment to us. You know our needs, you know and care about our struggles, and you understand our confusion and our distresses and our pains. Today, Father, would you come alongside those who feel abandoned or at a loss for understanding, or who find themselves with little hope? Would you provide strength that is needed for each life to be able to forge our way ahead with you through these challenges that we face? And among us here at Pleasant Grove Community Church, we know that there are those who are suffering the great pains of the loss of someone that they love. Would you stand close beside those who are in need of your presence to support them in these times, and the challenges of having to let go of someone that they dearly care for and love? God, would you be their support today? And would your mercy find a place in their heart, we pray. We pray for our country, God. We pray for the transition of leadership that's taking place. We pray for unity and healing in our country. We pray for the world and the needs that the world has. And we pray for the impact worldwide of this virus, that it would be turned, and that in its turning, you would restore people's lives to health and hope. All of our lives need your direction, your insight to help us move forward in the days ahead. And we look to you to reveal where we should place our steps in following you. Would you be our guide today? Be our great shepherd today, and cause us to walk in trust and in faithfulness as we follow you. Give us a resilient hope for the future. Establish in us, your church, a posture of compassion, of helpfulness, of hope, of patience, and for each of us to live the way that those who serve others as Christ has done. Would we be those kind of compassionate people, to be humble servants? May we be a church full of compassion and those who seek to honor your kingdom above all else and your kingdom's values. May we this Christmas season find our joy restored, our hope lifted to new heights, our hearts full of the peace that only you can bring, and our lives overwhelmed by your extravagant love. We pray in the love of Jesus all these things. Amen and amen. Well, this is the time when we would call for offerings, and I would just remind you that you can send in your offerings, mail those into the church to support the ministries of the church, as well as you can do online giving through our website. So I just encourage you to share either way that you can. And just a word of thanks during this time of Advent and our Advent season, to just say thank you for your faithfulness in giving, as you honor God in that way. And may we continue to give as God directs and guides us, so that we can complete this year strong and enter into the new year in a very financially healthy way. But may God honor you and bless you as you give.
Well, I hope you have been enjoying this day of music, this service of music that's been blessing you, lifting you up in worship. And I'd just like to share a few thoughts with you. Imagine, if you will, imagine your Christmas day went something like this. The kid is crying. You've been up all night. The house is a mess. You know, for some of you, you probably don't have to imagine it. You've been there, you've done that. But on top of that, the power is out. There's no lights, there's no cooking. And the plumbing is not working, and the toilets are backed up, and, well, it's starting to smell like the toilets are backed up. That's going to be a really, really rough Christmas day. But now imagine your house is nothing like that. Your house is clean. It is brightly lit. It's all decorated. There's sounds of laughter, and the smells are coming from the oven and not from the bathroom. That's better. However, you've been invited over for Christmas to the other house, the house that's a mess, the house where the kid is crying, where the power is out, where the toilets are backed up. Would you want to go to that house for Christmas? Probably not. But it's that kind of house that God came to on Christmas Day, a stable, no power, no water, smells and looks like a stable. Why? Why would God go to a house like that on Christmas? Why would God come to such a mess? Love. He comes because of love. 1 John 4:9 says, "This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him." That's our only verse for today's message. It's all we need. This is how God shows his love among us. He sends his one and only Son into the world. When Jesus came from heaven to earth, he came into a mess. But God wasn't looking at the mess. What God saw was a world he loves. Jesus enters into our mess. He enters into the mess of our lives, into the mess of your life, but he doesn't see the mess. He sees the love. He knows it's messy. That's why he came, but Jesus doesn't see the mess. He only sees the love he has for you. You know those closets you have in your life? You know, those places where you try to stuff all the bad memories and all the mistakes and all the things you've done wrong and all the ugliness and the pain of your life. You try to stuff it in there and close the door, hoping that out of sight will be out of mind. You've got closets like that in your life. I do. Jesus sees those closets. He sees into those closets, but he also sees through those closets. He sees past the imperfections. He sees past the sins and the mistakes. He sees past all those hurts. Jesus doesn't see the mess of our lives. No, with the eyes of an artist, what Jesus sees is the masterpiece he created. He sees you. And with the love of an artist, he comes to restore that masterpiece, to restore you. There is plenty of mess in the world, probably plenty of mess in your life, but I invite you today to take your eyes off of the mess and focus on the love. You're loved. You are treasured. You are worth dying for. You know, when Jesus was born, Mary no longer saw the mess. All she saw was Jesus. Look with those eyes. See Jesus in your own life. Look at the love God expressed at Christmas. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world. Your life might be messy, but Jesus does not see that mess. He sees the masterpiece. You're loved. Jesus came from heaven into the mess of your life because he loves you. Embrace that love. God's love for you is the greatest gift you can receive this Christmas. You might be someone who has not yet asked Jesus to be in your life. You might be someone who's not yet received the love God has for you. I'm going to give you that opportunity at the end of this message. Receiving God's love is the greatest gift you can receive at Christmas, but God's love is also the greatest gift you can give at Christmas. You know, when you look at the mess around you, see through it with the eyes of Jesus, with the eyes of love. And then as Jesus has loved you, love others the same way. And you might ask, well, what specific things can I do to love messy people? It's hard to know how to love them. Or is it? There's a Christmas story about an old shoe cobbler who on Christmas Eve had a dream that was so real, so vivid, he was certain it was going to come true. The dream was of Jesus coming to him and telling him that he was going to come and visit him that next day, Christmas Day. Like I said, it was so vivid, so real, that when the cobbler woke up, he knew Jesus was going to come and see him. So he quickly ran out and cut down some pine branches and decorated his shop and started a fire and sat down and waited for Jesus to come. And after a couple hours, Jesus hadn't shown up yet, but an old man had wandered in to get out of the cold and to warm up. And as the cobbler visited with him, he saw that the man had holes in his shoes. And so he reached up on the shelf and he pulled down a new pair of shoes and got some dry socks and made sure the shoes fit and sent the man on his way with new shoes and dry socks. And then he sat down, the cobbler sat down and continued to wait for Jesus to come. And while he waited, a woman walked into the shop, and she had not had a decent meal in a couple of days. So while he visited with her, he prepared a nice, hot, nutritious meal for her and then sent her on her way. And he sat down and continued to wait for Jesus, who wasn't showing up yet. And as he waited, he heard a boy crying outside his door. So he went to investigate and saw a little boy who had got separated from his parents. So he got his coat on and went out into the cold and helped the boy find his way home. And by the time he got back to his shop, it had gotten dark and the streets were now empty. And as he went back in the shop, he just kind of lifted his voice in despair and said, "Lord, Lord Jesus, why didn't you come?" You know where this is going, right? Then he seemed to hear a voice saying, "Oh, shoe cobbler, lift up your heart. I kept my word. Three times I knocked on your friendly door. Three times my shadow fell across your floor. I was the man with the cold feet. I was the woman you gave to eat. I was the boy on the homeless street." It's not hard to know how to love others. Just ask yourself, how would I treat Jesus? How would I treat Jesus and then treat other people that way? If you saw your neighbor as Jesus, how would you treat that neighbor? What would you say to them? What wouldn't you say to them? What would you do? What wouldn't you do? It's really not hard to know how to love someone when you see that person as Jesus. The hard part is seeing them as Jesus. The hard part is looking past the mess of their lives to see the person that's created in Jesus' image. As Christmas approaches, my challenge to you is to treat people as if they were Jesus. Your spouse, your children, your sons, your daughters, your grandchildren, your neighbors. Treat them as if they were Jesus. That person that you cannot fathom why they think the way they think and why they do the things they do, treat them as Jesus. The beggar on the street, Jesus. The angry person, the arrogant person, the the gay person, the impaired person, treat them as Jesus. God didn't see the mess when he came. He saw the world he loved. Mary didn't see the mess. She saw Jesus. Start trying to see with the eyes of Jesus, with eyes of love, past the mess. Start trying to see others and treat others as if they were Jesus. It will radically change your life. It will change your actions and the way you think and your heart. And before you know it, you'll start becoming the person that Jesus sees and loves underneath your own mess. Have you embraced the love of God? Have you allowed the love of God to enter in your life? All love requires surrender. Jesus surrendered heaven to love you. Jesus surrendered his life to love you. To receive that love, you need to surrender your own life to him, to ask him to come into your own life. Will you do that today? Will you do that right now? If you're ready to embrace the love of Jesus, to receive this greatest gift of Christmas, I'm going to lead you in a prayer where you will pray and just surrender your life to Jesus and ask him to come in. For those of you who have already done that, I encourage you to pray and ask Jesus to help you see others and treat others as if it was him. Let's pray. And if you're ready to receive this great gift of God's love, pray along with me. Dear Lord Jesus, I want to receive your love. I realize that I have broken spots in my life. I recognize that I'm a sinner who has not surrendered my life to you. But I believe that you are the Son of God who came to earth to save my sins. I believe that you died on the cross to forgive my sins. I believe you rose from the dead to give me new life. So now I surrender all of my life, for the rest of my life, to follow you. I ask you to come in and take over. Fill me with your love. Heal my wounds. Take away the bad memories. God, I thank you that at this moment, you have set me free. I thank you that at this moment, you have given me the gift of salvation. I thank you that at this moment, you have entered my life and you're already starting to fill it with love. Help me experience that love and share that love even this week. Amen. And if you're someone who just prayed that prayer to ask Jesus into your life for the first time, you just received the greatest gift you could receive at Christmas. But we want to give you an additional gift. We want to give you a gift that will help you grow and get really rooted in this new relationship with Jesus. So please let us know of this decision you made, and we'll send you a gift. All the information will be at the end of this video. But now, let us continue to worship God with some more sacred music.
Oh, Christmas!
Well, I hope you have been blessed by this service from beginning to end. Jesus didn't see the mess when he came. He with eyes of love, just saw his masterpiece. I encourage you to see with those eyes, to treat other people as God's masterpieces. God's love is the best gift you can receive at Christmas and the best gift that you can give. So, this week, as you prepare for Jesus to come from heaven to earth, I encourage you to help other people experience this Jesus as well. I encourage you to bring Jesus into their lives by treating them as if they were Jesus. I hope you'll join us again for our Christmas Eve service, and may you have a very Merry Christmas.